Welcome back to the System Administration MiniConf. For the end of our MiniConf, we have one final presentation. Julien is going to talk to us about learning from the mistakes that you avoided actually making. Over to you, Julien.
Hi. So yeah, this is a talk about an incident that never happened. It's a talk from a couple of years ago. And of course, despite testing this, the slide is not corresponding. A bunch of things have changed since. This is to get you thinking about your near misses, not much about the incident itself. Your cast of characters for this, at the time, I was a network SRE at Google in Sydney. These days I work on insider risk elements, still at Google in Sydney. And my compatriot is Chris Morrow, who is actually still in network security over in Reston, Virginia. One of the things of note here, we are two people on the other side of the planet. Neither of us are in California, home of Google, a lot of where our senior management are, nor are our teams actually represented. Due to some weird oddities of Google's network structure, we ended up with some teams in some weird locations, and some of that is still true, but things have consolidated since. Time zones are at the time, so as you can see, luckily we're both people that can do weird hours, but that's sub-ideal. So what happened, or what nearly happened? Well, one Monday morning, I get a poke from Chris going, "Hey, it's Monday morning your time. Do you mind rolling out this change we did on the weekend?" All right, why not? I'm at the office before lunchtime, weirdly. Yeah, I'll roll a change out, and I trigger off the tool that pushes production changes for that part of the network. Now, luckily, this tool takes a while to confirm what's actually in scope for the change. It ends up taking about a minute of prep. And while it was doing that, I just went and verified the diff in case other people had made changes and never pushed them, which is something that sadly was common at the time. This is not an element that was automated. There's reasons why at the time. And so I do a perforce diff because all our config is in perforce. And we're pushing rev 8. And quick check says rev 5 is the version live on the network. And the diff is really big. Okay. The file had actually been moved recently, which is why the revision numbers were low. Those are the actual revision numbers. Okay, check 5 and 6. Well, that's small and obviously legit. Check 6 and 7. Well, that's small and obviously legit. Okay, 7 and 8 is our change, but it's huge. It should also be small. Okay, so what did we end up doing? We changed the thing we were going to change, the actual intended change. But we also changed this magic number that was something we discussed on the change. But it's clearly something I thought we'd do later. So I go and check the list of magic numbers that's appropriate. And, it turns out that magic number is very, very important and should not have been removed. Now, luckily, that push tool before takes a final confirmation once it confirms what's in scope. And Control-C, it's not going to push. Quick revision control revert of the file. And no one pushing head will push that broken file, which is great. But what would have happened? Well, basically we'd have dropped Google's IP addresses. We would have stopped advertising most of Google's IP addresses to the rest of the internet. This breaks all sorts of things. We know, as well as, of course, all the Google services that would have been broken, there are ISPs that use reachability to Google as a proxy for we are connected to the internet. There's things that would have kept working. There's weirdness and some things would have kept working, but so little that calling it a complete outage is fairly reasonable. And because of an oddity of the way BGP works, both in general and in the very specific design of Google's backbone, this would actually have taken effect within 2 or 3 seconds for the entire change. or for the entire global backbone. Okay, so some context. Routes on the internet come from a bunch of different places. You might have directly advertised by a router connected to a LAN. You might have direct advertisement from systems like load balancers. You might aggregate the above, so your load balancers advertise 23 different IP addresses, and as long as any of those are up, you advertise the covering /24 route, IPv4 route. And you might have static routes, and anyone who's done a tiny bit of networking will hear static routes and go, oh, no, they're terrible, don't use them. Unfortunately, they ultimately are the least terrible option for a bunch of cases. So, for example, we have Google Public DNS, Quad 8. We have the route 8.8.8.0/24, and it doesn't have a location because it's anycast. It's not actually something we really want to advertise in a single place, so there ends up being a couple of reasons why we advertise some of our routes and essentially all the covering routes globally, centrally, through the system. And these routes look like this. They are a route, a comment that is possibly helpful, possibly not, and a bunch of magic numbers. And good luck remembering the magic numbers. Good luck remembering whether a 1 or a 0 is the correct thing to be in the fifth column. So some of these make differences, like advertise to the internet is important, advertise to peers is important, advertise to internet exchanges. Now, what actually happened was we have one that is prepend route in a certain situation. And because of weirdness, it's actually the combination of advertise the internet and prepend the route that was this magic behavior that we thought we had. And the reason why we thought we had this magic behavior is because one set of tooling for explaining these magic numbers, turning them back into human readable text, simply took the last definition. Didn't take the first definition. It didn't go, hey, there are multiple definitions. It took the last. And strictly, it shouldn't have taken a combination definition. But that was a bug. So what were we actually doing in the first place? We had a big block of IPv4 addresses, and we needed to break it up, assign some of the block to specific uses. So on a Thursday morning at my time, I made a comment seeing the CL that, oh, this block of addresses, we're not doing anything externally about them, so let's just remove those extra magic numbers. And we go on and do this, and Chris makes a comment, but hey, we're also setting these magic numbers, do they matter? And my comment was along the lines of, oh yeah, that's obsolete, it no longer does anything in the network. We're completely fine. We can just delete that everywhere. That's great. And I sort of assumed that would be a cleanup later. But Chris ended up doing it and submitting the change. So why did we get in this situation in the first place? Well, obsolete config wasn't cleaned up. If I had removed the behavior from the network, there shouldn't be references to it. There's some possible arguments for archiving your obsolete magic numbers in one place so you know not to reuse them. We had magic numbers humans were dealing with. Humans are terrible at magic numbers. That's exactly why we built tooling. But humans shouldn't need to deal with them. We had no tests. This is config. This is config we have some parsability of. We have some simulation frameworks. But they weren't practical. The one test we did have was a syntax compiler that I had written 1 week while getting very annoyed with something else. And it just validated that config looked like config. We had a network simulation framework, but the effort of actually spinning up a simulation was on the order of implausible to actually expect people to use. We had no clear ownership, and this is actually one of the bigger messes. We had the routing config at the time was regularly changed by people in three teams, and no team really wanted to own it because, well, none of us were really staffed to actually fix the things we wanted, and none of the other teams would accept that the other team fully owned it. It was very much a haunted graveyard, and shared haunted graveyards are even worse than the regular kind. It was also config that people were scared of touching. precisely because if you did bad, it would cause this exact outage, which is why it led to being out of date. And normally that's a problem. In this case, because it was out of date, I actually went and checked, and that's what saved us. All right, so that's what happened. What did we do? Well, okay, let's face it, it's a near miss. Nobody except the people within about 100 meters who heard me screaming actually knew that this happened. We can just move on. Nobody cares. We've reverted it. It's fine. We're all just going to move on, be happy. Yeah, not so much. So I was physically reacting to this 3 days later. I have a long history of working on major outages. Things don't tend to phase me very much. And if they do, they phase me in the moment. Once they're solved, I can move on. This one, possibly in part because I was part of the cause. Nope, I was actually physically responding for a couple of days. Now, when I wrote this presentation and was getting feedback from some of the other people I worked with at the time, I got the interesting question of, would we have been better off having the outage? Would that have been the shakeup we needed to get some of these underlying issues fixed? And I spent a whole bunch of time thinking about it, and my answer in this specific case is no, because we actually had a very similar outage in some ways that was far more specific, but it was far more specific in that it caused explicit pain to people that we most hate to cause pain to. So we had that and we didn't fix things then. So in this case, I don't think having the outage would have been better, but sadly that's a real consideration in some of these events. Okay, so what to do? Well, it was 3 days later. I wrote a postmortem. Postmortems being standard in Google across engineering, and very much so in site reliability engineering and NetOps. Wrote a postmortem. And I couldn't really get traction. People within my team cared. A couple of people in some of the other related teams cared. But I couldn't get management buy-in, which, it's a near miss, who cares? Had this happened, we certainly would have had meetings showing up with VPs, and it wouldn't be explain why I shouldn't fire you. It would be explain the situation and what you're doing to prevent it. But it's a real shame that it wasn't able to be used as that wake-up call that I think it was valuable to be. Now, I have a thing when I work on postmortems around haunted graveyard issues, which tend to be pretty common for me, they're a great time to document things because now you've got the incentive to go looking at the broken thing that's always been there. Write that in the postmortem. Tell a story. Around this time, one of my Dublin tech leads and I had collected this collection of our postmortems and those on related teams that were teachable. We used outages in these big, scary systems that everyone was worried about but depended on as ways to teach these systems and understand them and learn whether they're still doing the right thing. The other big thing I did is write a bunch of tests. We had libraries for this Juniper-style configuration, so I wrote some, and pretty much just going, the text looks like the text we expect. Checking a couple of the most obvious things. Are we advertising at least 100 routes to the internet? Do we have unique routes? Do we have the right magic numbers? Is the topology correct? And some of these are nice, useful tests to have regardless, because they show that assumptions we make about the network are true. And they don't always matter, but they do make things simpler. They reduce your cognitive load, and that's absolutely very helpful. One of my experiences with writing tests for this sort of config has been that every single time I do it, very quickly, and even sometimes latently, we discover they will stop outages. Sometimes we've had minor issues in the existing config that don't matter. Sometimes we discover the existing config would work fine on its own, but not when we build a full device with that config. Sometimes they're just minor formatting issues, but we still should get them correct just in case. I cannot remember whether it was with these tests or with some of the other work, but I discovered that about 200 lines of this file were commented out. Complete accident. At one point, the C style slash star, or star slash, was missing on a line. And we had a couple hundred lines of config just missing. And then a couple months later, this event happened in April-ish. And over the US Thanksgiving holiday, when things were quiet, I decided that, well, I was promised that the generator for this config is totally coming right now, we swear. And as it turned out, I think it's actually been delivered now, sometime last year, but in the end, it took quite a few years. So I wrote a quick Python script that took a protocol buffer input, because this is Google and our protocol buffer is essentially the default, and simply generated the file as an output. And that let me improve things, because now you can at least use the names for the magic numbers. Now, one big set of the magic numbers is the locations to advertise a route for. And instead of having 27 of them, except actually it should be 23, except we added one and forgot, which was the exact problem you have when you've got such magic number combinations, you simply say, advertise this everywhere, and it's all fine. And I was able to write that generator iteratively, essentially making sure every code change either was a single diff that a human could verify or was no diff. And that was really helpful because I could push the config and be sure I wasn't breaking the world. And that's it. Thank you very much. For those of you coming to the PDNS, have a good night.
Thank you very much, Julian. That was an excellent note to finish the SysAdmin MiniConf on. And thank you.